Hey there everyone, it's Sophie, Biotech Girl here. Today I have a kind of interactive video because I'm going to be talking about computer-aided design, but for biology. So let's get started with the basics. What is CAD? So CAD, as I was saying before, stands for computer-aided design, and we are talking about softwares that allow us to create stuff, to design stuff in 3D, in 2D. These can be, bicycles, they can be cell phones, houses, cars, cameras, whatever you're thinking about pretty much. And the reason why they're so helpful is because they allow us to have like an overview of our product, of our object. In 3D sometimes, so we have like everything in one place, and it's much more accurate, as you can imagine, if like compared to drawing the things by hand in a piece of paper and so on. So we have the different measurements. So this is really helpful. And in synthetic biology or genetic engineering or biological computing, we're not talking about designing 3D objects just yet, and as far as I'm concerned. However, we are going to be talking about that later on in this video. But as of now, I want to ask you, what do you think cells are? Are they burritos or are they rather computers? Well, actually, this is not like a yes or no question, and the truth is that experts are still trying to figure this out. But generally, we consider cells in their natural state to be more like burritos, and genetic engineering, synthetic biology is more about turning them into computers. It is about standardizing life, knowing what each one of the biological parts does, what each one of the organelles will react like when being in a certain condition and situation, and therefore be able to predict our experiments and not just wait for the results to come out and not knowing that before. In any case, if we want to program biological computers, we need to think as if we were programmers rather than researchers. So we need to know how computers work, right? We need to know that computers have inputs that are processed and then are turned into outputs. In this biological context, our inputs would be environmental conditions, substances such as genes, proteins, and other things. And the outputs would be the presence or the absence of a certain gene or a translated protein, like a gene that is turned into a protein thanks to the logic that we have as a process. And talking about the logic, we should know and go a little bit back to computer logic. So I'm going to be talking about the different levels of abstraction that are present in circuits. So yes, the top level is circuits, which are made up of logic gates, which are made up of transistors. And it's important to notice that I've been skipping a lot of steps in between, but these are like the ones that I consider to be the most important ones, at least when translating those into the biological context. So logic gates, there are different ones, and they're basically just what they sound like. They are based off of something called Boolean logic, which uses inputs and turns them into outputs. So you're gonna be hearing like these words a lot during this video, inputs and outputs and how they are processed. So you can think about different ways to call the inputs. They can be positive or negative, they can be on or off, they can be high or low, they can be right or wrong, they could be true or false. So they can be ones and zeros as well. So if we consider the AND gate, if we have a one and a one, we have two positive inputs, then we will have a positive input as well. If we have a zero and a one, we won't have a positive input because we need the first input and the second input to be true. Then for the OR gate, for example, we can have either of the two inputs to be positive in order to have a positive output. So input one or input two, if input one or input two is equal to one, is equal to true, then the output will be positive as well. And we also have like the NOT gate, which is like pretty much an inverter. Whatever condition that you have as an input, the NOT gate inverts that into the contrary input. So if you have one as an input, the NOT gate will turn that into a zero. And the NAND gate, for example, is a combination between the NOT and the AND gate, as well as the NOR gate, which is a combination between the NOT and the OR gate. And then we have some other ones, but just to go faster through this video, to get faster through this, we will start talking about genetic logic gates. So the first one that I can think of, kind of the most, the simplest one, is the AND gate. And this is not a computer-aided system, like a design that was created by that. I mean, it probably is, but it's not the one that I'll be talking about today. It's just a diagram, a representation of a genetic AND gate. So we have different parts. Don't be scared by this. The green and the orange rectangles are operators, which are basically parts, DNA strands, DNA parts that has, like, their sequence is like designed, their sequence is just was just born to allow for proteins to bind to it, you know. It allows for proteins to bind to it. And then the blue arrow is a promoter. After that, well, after the orange rectangle, we have something called RBS, which stands for ribosome binding sequence, and it is a blue ellipse. So that ribosome binding sequence means that basically ribosomes, once the protein is transcribed, ribosomes can bind to it so they can translate it. And after that, we have the coding region, which is a GFP, which stands for green fluorescent protein. So what this tells us, and I almost forgot, the black arrows are representing the environmental conditions that can act as activators for the operators. So let me explain this better. What this basically means, what this diagram means, is that the two environmental conditions, the two black arrows, will have to be present, will have to activate the two operators in order for the GFP gene to be transcribed. So we can have a statement such as, if the green rectangle and the orange rectangle are active, then the GFP gene will be transcribed. So if the two inputs are on, then the output will be on as well. And in this case, our output is the presence of the green fluorescent protein. And then we have some other logic gates. As you can see, this like field of biological computing has been advancing a little bit fast, because we already have like the logic gates that we need in order to create biological circuits, which is great. And I'm not going to be like explaining each one of them in a lot of detail, but what I want you to notice is that pretty much all of them have a ribosome binding site and genes as inputs and as outputs, and they also need an RNA polymerase enzyme to transcribe the coding sequence. But what's different for each one of these gates is the activator. So what I was talking about previously, the activators in this case would be like the black arrows, but in this case they're represented with a green ellipse. And this is basically what's going to vary, because we're going to have different inputs. So now let's go on to a more specific example and leveling up just a little bit the complexity for our biological circuits. So what I did as a project is something called toggle switch. And what you can see in the background image is basically just that, a toggle switch. You can maybe recognize it because it's all around our smartphones and electronic devices. It is that, like you can't see it very clearly, like just in the front end, but a toggle switch are two opposing parts that repress each other. Yeah, so you can have, for example, in genetics, we have two different genes. We have LACI and we have TETR. And these two, like if TETR is active, then it'll repress LACI and vice versa. So when one is active, it is going to repress the other one. So they're kind of in a fight. And what this will allow us to do is to keep like keep the input on, like keep that depending sequence on when the input is on as well. And in order to design this, I used a computer-aided design tool called SBOL. SBOL stands for Synthetic Biology Open Language. And supposedly there are a lot of applications that are based off of the SBOL framework. One of them, which is very famous, is called Shallow. The other one, ThinkerCell is not based off of SBOL as far as I'm concerned, but that's another one. And yeah, basically there are a lot of them. I think that another one is iSymbio or something like that from the University of Michigan. But unfortunately, I do need to mention that the only one that I was able to download was SBOL Designer, so the app SBOL itself, because the other ones, for example, Thinkercell didn't work for Mac, and the other ones were a little bit outdated. For example, Shello, which is supposedly a very recognized software to do these kind of things, didn't allow me to upload the sequences, the DNA sequences that I needed to create my project. And I also had some trouble with SBOL because I needed to download Java in order to use it. And then when I wanted to use it, supposedly the reason why SBOL Designer is so useful is because it allows you to assign a DNA sequence to each one of your biological parts, like a DNA sequence to a promoter, a DNA sequence to a ribosome binding site, and to a coding sequence, and so on and so forth. But I wasn't able to do this. I don't know why. And so, anyways, I will start explaining what my project was actually about. Yeah, well, you can actually see that it didn't work because you can see like these yellow triangles that indicate an error. But anyways, the three levels of abstraction that you can see here are first the two opposing parts, which will be the toggle switch themselves. And then if we zoom in to the TEDR inverter, we'll be able to see a promoter, a gene, and a terminator. So the promoter will basically like tell the cell, hey, it's time to transcribe this gene. The terminator will tell it, stop transcribing these gene. And then the gene is made up of a ribosome binding site and a coding sequence, which again, I wasn't able to assign a DNA sequence to. But anyways, if we zoomed into the other part of the toggle switch that says gen, we would also be able to see something similar, except we would have two genes instead of only one. So that is pretty much a genetic toggle switch. And just as a conclusion, I would like to mention that this was a pretty fun project. At the beginning, it was kind of challenging to decide which kind of genetic circuit I would like to do and on which platform I would like to develop it. And yeah, like, I don't want this to sound like a complain, but it was kind of difficult to work with these kind of softwares. It was maybe because it was my first time working with them and I didn't get like a lot of help. But I really would love to see more developers like doing their these kind of programs, creating them and making them more accessible for people, like to make them easier to download. And yeah, basically just keep an eye on them, because it just looked like if they were high school projects whose developers just forgot about them after they got the grade or something. But I definitely think that computer-aided design software for biology is going to be a thing. It's already a thing. It is helping a lot of people who are able to use them correctly and precisely to design better and more complex biological systems. So this was it for me. And as always, I can't wait to see what you create. Bye.